a middleweight, you know, from the amateur. So it's not like he was weighing 170 and, you know, and scaling down. So he's gone, grown through the weight classes also, and I think it's just over the last two or three years that he's been in the 50s.
Yeah.
You know, how he's conducting that situation. So I don't look at him as what you would say entry-level middleweight. I would just say that he, you know, he grew into a middleweight, however which way it was, whether it was through the training or his natural growth process. But he wasn't there initially as a middleweight.
Are you afraid that he's going to actually walk in a ring at 175 or something like that?
Well, since there is no clause, you can't worry about that. You know, 175 put on in 24 hours is not something that I think is really beneficial in the sense of an advantage if the other person can fight. So I don't see that. You know, I mean, it's a huge jump in weight. You know, I'd like to be a fly on the wall and see how he eats. In fact, he eats all this.
When you got
over what he does to get there, you know, it's kind of amazing to me. But you know, it is what it is.
Why do you like this fight for Amir? What are the things about it you may have seen other guys do against Canelo you think that fits?
Yeah. Well, initially, I didn't like the fight before it was confirmed when it was being talked about. I didn't like it, but I hadn't seen Amir. He was still in the UK. So when he came to camp, I was quite surprised how he had grown. You know, just filled out and I had a conditioning coach over there with him for 8 weeks before he came. We didn't know who we were going to fight, but just to give him a head start. So when he came at 66, 67, you know, with his abs already quite pronounced and things like that, I remember saying to myself, we don't have a problem getting to 47 because we did the last two fights have a problem getting to 47. Not a problem, but it wasn't easy. We had to be real meticulous about it. So I don't know if you'll ever see 47.
So he's not far from a real legitimate junior middleweight?
No, he's going to scale down to 55. Mm-hmm. Yeah, he's not going to go up. He's going to come down, you know, 55. And if he's 60, 61 the next night, I think that's a good weight gain, a logical one. And, you know, middleweights can knock out heavyweight. So it, I don't think the weight will be that much of a factor because I haven't seen Canelo yet use his weight. He's not a pressure fighter like a Roberto Duran or a Joe Frazier, and know how to use his size to lean on you and cut the ring and put a lot of pressure on you. I don't think he has the stamina to do that, and that's just not his style. So I think the weight might be a little exaggerated in the sense of his effectiveness, that I don't think his weight wins him fights.
Virgil, when Amir was in here with us just now, he said the weight isn't a factor in his regard because you're either born with speed or you're not. As Amir goes up in weight, do you agree with that sentiment that you can maintain that same level of speed even at a higher weight?
Sometimes it's even quicker because, you know, I had to, coming down to 147, you know, he would come to camp at 160, 161, so I'm able to see him in sparring pass through 54 and 55, and quickness is there from day one, so the speed is there from day one. So he's not going to lose any speed, you know, and I'm more interested in his quickness as opposed to his speed. You know, speed is in the body, quickness is in the mind, so I'm more interested in his quickness as more than his speed.
Are you concerned about the way that Canelo wins or gains after the waiting for the next day?
No, as I said earlier, you know, in my, just could just be me, I think that's a lot of weight to put on, and they might want to take a look at that before he gets in a situation that they say maybe we shouldn't have done that. So far, you know, it's, with the exception of Mayweather, he's gotten by with it. But there could be people down the line that he might say to himself, maybe I shouldn't have put on that kind of weight. And then, you know, I really, in my gut, don't think he's going to get that heavy. I think that he'll try to come in light in this fight.
When Amir spars, do you see a newfound sturdiness to him when you watch
him? He's always been sturdy. And you know, because, you know, when people talk about punching, you know, first of all, he shouldn't have never been in there with Prescott at that stage of his career. Okay? That was not his fault. That's something else. You don't put a prospect, I don't know, I think he had 10, 11 fights or something, in with a puncher at that stage of his career. You bring the puncher to the gym, you know, let it be free without nothing on there. You know, that's how he learns to deal with punchers. You bring sparring partners in that can punch, so he gets used to it, you see. Even though you have the headgear on, you still get used to it because a guy who could punch, it goes through your body. So it's just not limited to one spot. So he'll get used to that type of jar, and then he'll develop that alertness and develop that ability to, you know, to foresee something like that. So he shouldn't have never even been in there with Prescott. But I say this, he didn't see the first punch, hook that hit him. He got up, you see. So a lot of things could have happened in that fight if the corner was very smart, because personally, I'd have sent somebody running around there real quick and told him to take a knee as soon as the ref let Prescott come back in, and tell him to stay there. And if I tell you to tell him to take another one, take another knee, you see. And now I've gotten him 20 seconds, 25 seconds, but you have to prepare him long before that happens, because I tell all the kids in the dressing room, if you go down, find me, walk, don't let the referee tell you to walk, you walk immediately so I can see what's going on, so I can give you the hand signal to take a knee. If I feel like you're all right, give you the signal to run around the ring. Don't throw a punch, you already lost the round. What you fighting for? You lost the round, okay? The only way you win the round is to knock him out. The only way you even the round is to knock him down. You lost it. So let's get back to the corner and regroup. When you got a kid like him who can win 5, 6, 7 rounds in a row, right? You can take a knee twice. So if he'd have took a knee, it could have been a different outcome in that fight. But he went back in showing that heart, and he wanted to man it out. And then, so that lets me know, you know, he can take a punch because he got up. Mm-hmm. Garcia, and we have to remember, these were punchers. Mm-hmm. It wasn't some light-hitting person. These were guys who could punch, mm-hmm. right? Garcia was a guy who could punch with his left hook. Okay, he got up from that, and he actually started landing on Garcia again. Mm-hmm. He did his job. He made it back to the corner, okay? I don't know what was said in the corner. I'm just saying what I would have told him was, don't throw a punch the next round. Because, you know, when you have to prepare him in camp, if this happens, you use your lead hand, you keep your defense tight, and you're going to hear me constantly say, don't throw a punch. And let the round go. You're already up, what, 3 rounds to nothing. So he knocked you down. Now it's 3-2, right? You give him a round, it's even. But I already know you can outbox him. So my job is to get you back in the boxing mode and quit trying to go for the knockout. That fight was lost at the first press conference.
Hey, he took a big shot against Maidana but survived.
He
saw
it.
You remember how?
You understand what I'm saying? That's what I was getting to. Yeah. He didn't see those, but he saw Maidana's right hand. So he took it, you see? Now, we can honestly say Maidana's right hand is on par with Prescott and Garcia's hook. His right hand, he torques it, right? But he saw the punch, so he took it, and he survived the fight. He didn't even buckle. Think about it, he didn't even buckle. So he can take a punch, and these are punchers. Let's remember, these are punchers. So, but that Garcia fight was lost in the first press conference.
Why do you say that, Virgil?
Because when Angel started insulting his race, and things like that, he took it personal. When he told him right there on the podium, I'm gonna knock your son out, somebody should have got him and said, wait a minute, hold it. You know, but he's from Manchester, he's not from the ghettos or the hood where you know what Angel's doing. And I'd have got him and said, hey, that's not gonna work. You know, just save it, because I'm a, he's not from the ghetto, but I am, so I'm a hippie to it, okay? So he's not going to take it personal. That's your only shot to get him out of his game and get a punch through. You see, also starting from the root to the fruit in the amateurs, when you, I believe all coaches should start with young kids. You have to grow into it just like anybody else grows into a business. And if you'd have done that, you'd have known that from the different regions that the kids come from all over across the country from the national tournament, you know when you're being set up for a hook. Jose Garcia was doing that from the second round on. He was throwing the hook with his head down and ducking and throwing the hook. And people say, why is he ducking? He's closing his eyes. No, he's looking at his feet. He knows if his feet are there, he knows he's there. See? So you hear people say, move your head. Well, I know you never thought about it. People say, move your head. Well, if your feet are there, you're still there. It doesn't make a difference. The speed bag is faster than the head, but since it's on the platform, you can hit it. But if it was on a track, you wouldn't be able to hit it, see? So he was lining him up for the hook. He kept putting the hook on his shoulder. That's Philadelphia. Anybody knows that. Where it's taught, the Philadelphia left hook is to check the different things and to check the, where the body is, the feet are, so you know where the head is. But he got up from it.
Is Canelo a puncher too? You mentioned the other guys. Is he a puncher?
Well, look, all the fighters can punch. If you knocked out two, you can knock out another one. It doesn't matter who it is. Okay, you just need all the elements lined up right, yeah. Right? But if I have to be honest in my study of him, he's only knocked out one junior middleweight, and that's James Kirkland. Well, everybody knew that because Kirkland was picked at the right time. He was picked, he was hyped as dangerous, but really he wasn't. He hadn't fought in a year and a half. He got 8-week notice to take off 40 pounds. You cannot do that and be effective. So Kirkland lost through good managing on Canelo's team. They picked him at the right time. Trust me, if he was in that gym and still fighting, they might not have picked him for that fight. So, but we have to remember, Japanese guy knocked Kirkland out in one round, he couldn't break an egg and knocked him out, right? So the guys he has knocked out has been considerably smaller. Jose Cito Lopez, Alfonso Gomez, but then you have Ricky Haddon going the distance, Rhodes going the distance, Trout and everybody else. So who have you seen him wobble since Kirkland and before Kirkland?
No, you're right.
Nobody. He hit Angulo a dead man, and I know because I was in the corner.
Right.
But Angulo didn't listen to me. I told him 2 months before they gave him the fight he was going to get the fight. Get up here and let's start working. He didn't do it. They gave him a 7-week notice. They, you know, took a frog and fattened him up for a snake, right? I'm on TV, and I see him sitting there with Eric. I see him sitting there with Oscar, and I told Eric, you guys looking at him, you see he's fat. You calling the gym down there to see if he's in the gym? I know boxing, right? And I told him, they're calling the gym, man. They're giving you, they letting you sit next to him and everything. Oh, how you doing, man? Boom, 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 see? So, and then they just stretched the date out as long as they could, right? So you had to kill yourself making weight. It was a fat farm camp. It wasn't a boxing camp. He had to take the weight out. He fainted the morning of the weigh-in. If I hadn't been in the bathroom, he'd have busted his head. It wouldn't have been a fight. So he was a dead man, and he got hit with every punch in the book and never took a back step. He just kept coming forward.